Then I just answered, it cannot be considered like that. Wherever we consider that we are in advanced faith, that is not a compensation, that is not a relevant and righteous compensation to what we have lost. We have lost a lot of things, no doubt we have gained few things, but whatever we have gained is not a relevant compensation, righteous compensation for what we have lost. So we have gained in some other way, which is aimless and which is having no control or proper directive mechanism, and whatever we have lost is irretrievable and easily not compensatable by means of what we call as advancement or development. That's what I mentioned. So here, the present position is in such a manner that we have to concentrate upon so many things, irrespective of, in spite of the various so-called climate technological advancements that we now boast that we have achieved. And what is civilization, somebody asked? What is the difference between our civilization and other civilizations, and what is the parameter for a civilization? Perfect civilization, what we call a sublime status of civilization, how we can measure it? Three things are to be understood in civilization. If person understands three things, then he becomes well civilized. What is behind him, what is beyond him, and what is around him? If these things are understood, that is not a civilization. Understanding things behind everything is known as science. Understanding things around him is known as society and environment. Understanding everything beyond him is known as understanding of God. These three things are known as the hallmarks or the parameters of civilization. Understanding the fundamentals of everything, which is known as the foundation of science also, is ontology. And understanding everything, living being, subhuman species, the physical and biological and environmental factors, understanding everything is known as ecology. And understanding the binding factor, which by its connective will has created everything, sustained everything, absorbs everything, and manipulates everything by its own power and will out of infinite mercy, only for the sole cause of upliftment of mankind towards the pathway of knowledge, realization, and emancipation. So it is known as ecology, ontology, and theology. So a person becomes fully civilized when he understands and reacts. That's what I told. Civilization has two phases. The first phase is to know how to use everything for him. The second phase of civilization, real advanced civilization, is how to be useful to those things which are around him. So it prevents a person from exploitation. It prevents a person from special domination or special supremacy. It prevents the person from going against nature. So how to be useful to the nature which has bestowed its choices to beneficent showers on him, it is known as real civilization. And there are two models of civilization. One is known as origination model, and second is known as advancement research model. What is origination model? How civilization originated? Our system of philosophy has a very unique system of understanding about civilization. It is known as born-mature model. It deals with the rishis. So what it states is, civilization is not gradual. It is not by a process which undergoes for several millennium of years, by which the person gradually understands about something which is at the last. The Veda says that at the time of creation itself, along with the uncivilized creatures and subhuman species and various varieties of human beings, especially delegated people for the installation of Jnana Parampara, for the installation of lineage of wisdom, they have appeared by a special sankalpa, visishta sankalpena jayante maharshayaha. Everybody, like samanyas, what we call normal human beings, who were by means of a process they developed, maharishis were also created by God simultaneously with full maturity, the maturity to control themselves and go for a deeper meditation for understanding the perfections and precisions of the world. So they are born mature. There are three models in this. One is known as base model theory, second is simultaneous emergence theory, and the third theory is culmination theory. Base theory says that at first only the spiritual realization came. Only from the spiritual realization, creation of the world, development of what we call civilization, what we read about civilization is understanding fire, then understanding about clothing, understanding how to eat cooked food, and domestication of animals, agriculture. These things we consider to be the marks of civilization. But the base theory is that civilization started with a primogenitor, and a group of primogenitors who are known as rishis or brahmas, somebody else. Those people who are born mature, they installed the process of creation. So civilization only created the world, and from world there is also one more process of simultaneous emergence which cannot refute the rishis tradition who are born mature. Second thing I have already told, simultaneous emergence. When human beings, when they went for filling their belly, simultaneously, maybe a day after or before, simultaneously, gradually, this also started the quest for brain and the quest for the craving for the soul. So everything started simultaneously, they emerged with different people or in different places. Culmination theory states that your person starts from Annamaya Kosha, that is to take care of his own self, then gradually develop his own shelter, his family, his nearby or proximate society, then a broader society, then dealing with the universal spirit. So this says about the universal theory or the theory of culmination by which a person understands the so-called civilization which I mentioned at the end. Whereas we believe that civilization is ever existing. The manifestation of civilization to several places, to several persons in several grades may be different, but it is ever existing as per our shastras. So we have been trained by, we have been ruled by, we have been initiated by a well mature complete structure model of Maharishis who were consummate in their status, who are not just by observation or by experimentation, verification, cross verification, referential status or environmental study. These things are not by those people. Whatever we have observed by observation, they have done by closing their eyes. We require an additional tool for our eyes to see and verify something. They closed even the basic tool, eye, and they have looked upon the things. We have to move here and there for gaining something. They have sat on a tree, underneath a tree, on a fire, just in one leg, in various postures. They just maintained uniformity and internal harmony by which they could see everything reflected inside in inertia without doing anything. So this is the greatness of our tradition. So we believe in the Maharishi tradition, whereas the other civilization, they said it is simultaneous emergence and it may be even culmination type of rule. And advancements, what we are seeing, everybody is saying that we are advanced. How we are advanced? Is it absolute advancement or apparent advancement or apparent advancement? Absolute advancement means that we must be very happy. Apparent means we must be having more happiness and more comfort. Whatever we are seeing is apparent advancement, in which the inner sense is burning and we are very much comfortable with an outer ornament. So whatever we are seeing is apparent advancement. So what we want to bring is, shastras bring three major benefits. Salvation as the ultimate benefit, solution to problems, this is the second benefit, and solidarity to face the problems is the third benefit. So it gives you comfort to face the problems, as well as to solve the problems, as well as to get out of the hold of the problems themselves by a process known as eternity, in which you go to salvation. These things are assured in our shastra. So the advancement now available is only apparent advancement. So this clearly shows that we are having a role in teaching and guiding others, before which we must be well taught and well guided by our own people here, either in the form of treatises or in the form of tutors or in the form of transcendental authorities who are invisible going to guide us. First, we must be well trained and guided before facing others and before comforting other people. So, there are three types of people according to shastras who will come for the renaissance of civilization. One is known as Uddharaka, second is Vyavasthapaka, third person is Sthapaka. A person who is born at the time of the inceptive stage of the universe to inculcate the systems of three lines of philosophy, they are known as Uddharakas. Great people or even divine incarnations are known as Uddharakas. And persons who are in the continuous lineage to organize things through works, by teachings, by comfortable methodologies of tuition and by the divine embrace. We used to say Dikshana, Sparisha, Bodhana, Smarana, Kripa. By various these tools of a touch, by thought, by transmission, by transfiguration, by just showering the mercy upon the person, they were able to tutor those people for getting that knowledge. They are known as Vyavasthapakas. And whenever this Vyavasthapaka parampara, this lineage is going in declination, at that time, for its reinstallation, lot of people, they are going to come, they are known as Samsthapakas. So we had lot of Uddharakas now, we cannot become Uddharaka. Lot of people, they are well established. We have lot of Vyavasthapakas. Now what we want is a Samsthapaka. That is why any organization is known as Sthapana, Samstha or Samsthapana. Because the duty is to reinstall the glory, to establish it in